Well, hi, this is Bob Odell with Root Source, and we're with Dr. Brad Young, translator of the New Testament, and I'm getting to ask some questions about some passages. So, will you please turn to page 321? We're going to Ephesians chapter 2.
Yes.
And I just like to read. I just love the way this reads. I just want to hear your commentary on chapter 2, verses, let's say, 14 to 18. After all, and I get to read this. No, you read it. You read that whole paragraph, 14 through 18. Let's hear.
Okay. After all, he himself is our shalom, who made both peoples into one. He broke down the barrier of the dividing wall between us, having abolished the hostility, even our sins, revealed by ordinances and commandments of the Torah in his physical body, so that in himself he might make the two into one new creation, establishing shalom. As a result, he would reconcile them into forming one body to God through the cross by himself, having put to death the hostility. Moreover, he came and proclaimed shalom to you who were far away, as well as shalom to those who were near. Through him, we both have gained acceptance before the Father in one spirit.
My question is, would you just speak to those passages? Maybe anything you want to say, what they mean to you, your process of getting to the heart of them in the translation?
Yeah, this is one of those passages where I think we have to see the context of the Apostle Paul. And I think sometimes there is this argument that's going on in early Christianity, some that are saying you need to be circumcised and keep the whole Torah. But here you really see that he's saying there's a hostility that is revealed through our sinfulness. I mean, I think sometimes people, when they're reading the New Testament, they'll see Paul use Torah. Romans 7 is a very good example when we read
right.
7. Well, the Torah shows your sinfulness. But even so, in Romans 7, he says the Torah is holy, the commandment is spiritual, it's just, it's good. But on the other hand, when we look at the Torah, there is hostility in the sense that it shows human weakness, frailty. And so here you see this division, our sin, the Torah reveals our sin, is bringing this division between non-Jews and Jews. But through the Messiah, the Torah is being revealed in a way that Jews and Gentiles come together. I would say coming to faith in Jesus, an ethical monotheism, to live in the Spirit, to receive peace from God. Mm-hmm. But, you know, the way that this is sometimes translated, if you notice when I said the hostility, to make it clear, this is what I call a functional equivalency we have in square brackets, even our sins. Now, the Greek text doesn't say that, but I think if we look at Romans 7, we look at Colossians, we look at other parts of Ephesians, that really helps you understand it a little better.
Yes.
It's what we call a functional equivalency. So the hostility is even our sins, revealed by the ordinances and commandments in the Torah. It's not that the Torah itself is evil, but it's revealing this, and as a result, it's death. It's kind of like Romans 8. Is the Torah is the spirit of life, it's the spirit of death. Some people say there's two Torahs. One is of Jesus, one is the Jewish Torah. Some people have eight different Torahs. But if you look at the way Pharisees use Torah, you know this, Bob, from your many experiences with Orthodox Jews, Torah is so much bigger. You know, it's God's plan, it's God's strategy. Torah can be life. Torah can be death. It depends on our response to it. If you respond in faith, it's life. And so that's what Paul, I think, is saying here, that Yeshua in himself made the two one by bearing our sins, taking them to the cross, ending the hostility. And I think this is something really big in Romans 10. I think this relates to Romans 10:4, often translated, for Christ is the end of the law. Well, how can that be right when we read in Romans 3:31 that Paul says, do we cancel the law by the preaching of faith? He says, make anointed, it can't be, never be, God, heaven forbid, heaven prevent it. No, the word end there is telos, should be goal or purpose. He says, for Christ is the goal of the Torah. What is the goal in Romans 10? It's about the non-Jew and the Jew coming together in faith. And the whole goal of the Torah, and we see this in the 8th century prophets, Isaiah, Micah, they have this vision that non-Jews will go to the temple. My house shall be called a house of prayer for all peoples. You know, they have a court for the Gentiles. They want them to come and pray. I liked one scholar, you know, they said, I think there was a little bit of humor. It says, well, they're all going to come and pray. They didn't think they were going to be circumcised when they got there. Now, it's a little humorous in a way, but it's really the argument in the New Testament. Because some says, well, we got to circumcise them before they go in there. And we got to make sure that they're going to keep kosher. And they're going to, and Paul says, forget that. They need to have faith in God. They need to be ethical. They need to live the faith, but they don't have to be pretend Jews to be accepted. And if they want to do more, they can. If they want to do less, but they have to live this up. And so here he's saying, the hostility is gone. We're one creation. We're coming to faith. And, you know, he is very Christocentric. He's very Mashiach-centric. And, you know, I think we would see this in other Jewish messianic movements in history, you know, that here, through Mashiach, this hostility is being taken away, and there's that oneness that comes. I think that's why you and I, as evangelical Bible believers, I don't know that we never like terms people use to describe us, but you know, we have this faith in the Lord and love for the Word, and we have this love for the Jewish people. I think this is something that's happening to many people today. They develop a love for Jews. I've had people tell me, you know, I never liked Jews until I really accepted Christ. And all of a sudden, I love Jewish people. I can't, you know, and people have a default. You know, we have some teachings or prejudice. We have things that are wrong that we've learned from family. Well, when we start reading the Newer Testament, one of the things we're trying to do is challenge these in a way that you read the Newer Testament without these prejudices, and maybe a translation that's Jewish friendly in a sense, yeah, that it opens up maybe another way of seeing this, so that all of a sudden you have an understanding with the love in your heart. So I think many people have a love in their heart, but they don't have that understanding. And sometimes it's because of the way we've been taught, or, and you know, translators do the best they can with the Greek text, and we have very good translations. I feel very humble and inadequate in translating the text. I would say translators know something.
You mean you don't walk on water now?
No, I mean, you know something. No, some texts, other texts are very hard to translate. And I'm very grateful for much help that I've had from others. But I would say, you know, a better translation, trying to get those things a little clearer, opens up a new word. And I think here is a good point, that a different translation may help you see the main point, yeah, of the unity and the love. And it's not an attack on Torah. It's saying the Torah reveals our sinfulness, but the Torah also brings us to be one through the work of Messiah.
That's beautiful. I find it interesting that way back in early segments talking about your life, you said, you know, you didn't grow up wanting to translate the Bible. You went to Israel and you saw that there was a need for a better translation, but you didn't necessarily take that up right away. And now it's been a 25-year process to bring out this book. I just want to bless you and say, yeah, I believe this is coming out at the right time. I believe that there is an openness of heart within the people of God, Jew and non-Jew, that that a translation that affirms the Hebrew heritage of the New Testament, this is something that I believe can be received. And praise God, I hear from you, there's some success in this. People are getting excited, and you're getting some very good sales. So bless you in that. But I'd like to bless you and the Gospel Research Foundation and the HebrewHeritageBible.com to have outstanding success above and beyond whatever you could have imagined. That not for your sake, but for the sake of the world, because we need this. And I'm so privileged to be able to interview you today because of the work that you stepped into and what you've done. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you, Bob. That's very kind. Appreciate it so much. Thank you.
So, HebrewHeritageBible.com.
And that's the main thing that people can read and enjoy and discover a new depth of their faith. Read the New Testament. Read the Bible. Study the Bible.
Love it. Let's put them both together. There. Okay. There you have it. Thank you so much for this time. And until next time, Bob Odell, Dr. Brad Young.
Thank you.
Shalom.